This is Too Many Words with Jayme Bedingfield. Welcome to the show. I'm happy to be here. Podcasting is something I look forward to. Now, Tuesdays and Wednesdays are fun. Some of the highlights. Plus, it's something else for me to obsess about and get painfully nervous before doing. So, I like it. I have best-selling horror author Robert Sharkey Pruneda on the show tonight. He is author of Devil's Nightmare, which I'm reading right now. And there is also Premonitions, which is the second in the series. And I'm really liking it so far. It's intense and keeping my attention. Rob and I have the same publisher, and we cross paths occasionally. And I saw a few weeks ago a post he made about The Walking Dead. And we got to talking. I started commenting, and we went back and forth a little bit about The Walking Dead. And then I decided, I was like, come on the show, and let's keep talking about it.
So I look forward to chatting with Rob later. He'll be on in a little bit.
How are you guys doing right now? I hope well. I'm okay. Some of you are probably better than others. Unfortunately, that's life. It's not always fair. Without the rain, we would not appreciate the sunny days and, well, and would ultimately stop being able to survive. On Earth, global warming makes me nervous. Every year, you know, right around this time, probably a couple weeks in at this point, normally mid-March, we have an ant problem in my house. They wake up before the spiders. They're scurrying around my baseboards, telling me my house is filthy. And I go on this whole war with it. I buy all these new cleaning products. I have my mop. I'm obsessed about it. I'm following my family and my dogs around saying, you know, don't, no crumbs. You'll call the ants. This year, there's no ants. There's just really big spiders. Like 2 months before I normally see spiders. So it's interesting. I'm guessing it has something to do with global warming. That's twice now. When I went to say warming, I almost said warning. So maybe that's a warning. Yeah. So does fear consume you? Does being afraid of the outcome of something keep you from doing it? Do you think about someone jumping out of the bushes while you are getting a case of ginger-infused cider out of your trunk? I have to answer yes to all three of these questions. I'm nervous and fearful, and sometimes when I'm in a shopping mall, I actually picture myself as a field mouse. You know, people are hustling around. There's all this tension. Half the people don't want to be there. There's all these bags. And I'm just like, overstimulation. Try to just kind of walk as fast as I can, maneuvering around everybody. You know, quickly to the exit. But I really think all of you can answer yes to those two. Sometimes I get caught up. Thinking about how different and special I am, but I don't think so. I'm officially convinced that everyone is as neurotic as I am. Yep, I'm going with that. I like it. Talking about doing errands, the other day, I headed out to go to, you know, just take care of some things, and it was just like the energy out there. Like I guess I am sensitive to energy, and sometimes not, you know, that much, and But I don't mean energy like, ooh, I don't know. Anyway, so I was, you know, just headed out, and I get onto the main road closest to, like, where I live, and somebody is right in my ass, really close, doing the swerving thing behind me, like, and I'm going the speed limit, it just shot me out. Sometimes it makes me, you know, want to drive, like, really slow, you know, have fun with it. But for whatever reason, it just stressed me out. And I was like, so I decided to not go to Trader Joe's, but to go to a grocery store, actually smaller and closer. So I make a turn there. And then I have somebody behind me beeping at me to make a right turn on red. And yes, there's no sign forbidding it, but there's also no opening. There's just steady traffic. So yeah, you know, I ended up just turning around, deciding I'd try another day. I didn't do my errands. I went home. And opened up book.
But yeah, I got upset that I did that.
Which happens.
There is a fine line between taking care of ourselves and blocking out the world in a way one would use a fire extinguisher. The next day, I tried going to the store again, and this time I pretended I was at the beginning of the apocalypse. I was stocking up for supplies, and when I was driving down 99, I imagined just zombies everywhere. Honestly, it didn't take much imagining, but somehow this made the whole trip less stressful and kind of fun, actually. You know, modern day society is intense, and I could add many more sentences of fluff and afterthought to that, but it doesn't need it. It just is. It just is. But yeah, I got my lavender soap and my apricot cheese, and everything's good again. I'm afraid of a lot of things. You know, I've had more than a handful of fears alongside of a plate of worry for as long as I can remember. Really, I've always been kind of nervous. And again, I don't think I'm alone here. I think everyone is nervous. Some of us admit it, and some of us don't. Part of my fearfulness is rational, and part of it, you know, not so much. You know, part of it is just, you know, you be careful of touching the hot thing because you'll burn yourself. That's common sense. That's the kind of fear, you know, where we need it to survive. But then, you know, I think fear gets really strange from being a parent because I look at my kids and, you know, they'll just, you know, one of them will be jumping on the sofa. And, you know, I'll say, you know, get off, stop it. And they'll be like, why? And I'll say, because you can die. So, you know, making them neurotic too. So that's good. But, yeah, death scares the shit out of me. I don't know what happens afterward. And, you know, no one really does. We have guesses. We have hopes. We have beliefs. But, you know, when push comes to shove, we don't know what happens. And I know, again, the theme. I know I'm not alone here. A lot of people. Death scares a lot of people. And when it's in our lives, when we lose a friend or a loved one, or even, you know, even for people, they just need to hear about it. And it reminds us that, you know, we're mortal and that this is temporary. As a parent, that fear of death transforms into a responsibility, in keeping others alive, which in return, you know, makes me want to just tell my kids to stop whatever they're doing. It doesn't matter what they're doing. I want them, you know, stop, be safe. but yeah, scary world. It's constantly changing, you know, not saying that's bad, you know, change is part of life. It happens. It's what happens. But it is, it's changed a lot. You know, and the, you know, the near future of the country, it concerns me. That's all I'm going to say there. But it does. I think we're all fearful. And the thing, that makes our stomachs clench, is different. It varies. And at some point it crosses over. Our fear can become something that, you know, urges us on, eggs us on. It, this is and isn't good depending on what it is, but it's definitely something that happens. I'm going over the last half of, I just finished going over the last half of the Mentally Powerful, over the last couple of days. There was this possible inconsistency that popped in my head, and I had to check on it. So it didn't contribute to my sleep problems, and I don't want to give anything away, but book two is intense, and I had to get into an intense mindset to work on it. And like any of my writing, you know, it gets into my dreams, which, you know, honestly isn't that great. This is not to be confused with that I dream and then I write. That is not the case at all.
I just obsessively think about my characters and my plot to a point that it, you know, it buys an estate in my subconscious. The subconscious is a crazy thing to think about. I wonder about the power of our subconsciouses. It feels like one of those things, like the ocean and space. You know, there's just so much we don't know there. I have issues. I have issues with people. Don't get me wrong. There are people I care about. There are people that are in my life as a regular part. People I care very much about. And I do as my best as a parent to foster a healthy social habits. Some weeks I do better than others. But it's one of those things where I don't have the best social habits. I never really did. And, you know, by virtue, I want to teach my parent, my teach, you know, teach my kids to do better than I. For the most part, I'm either terrified of the general public or just totally pissed off by it. Sometimes I feel like just a ball of nerves trying not to yell, you know, and I think I'm having a strange week. Still having trouble turning off my mind and, you know, and still not sleeping the best. I think if I got the opportunity to go superpower shopping, I'd end up getting something that ups my productivity. Even like if flying is right there, if there's like another power, like, you know, the super to-do list or aider, you know, that's just kind of probably the one that I would end up getting, even if I got another one. And I would leave the store with it. I'd come back and return it for that one. I'm stubborn and obsessive. These are qualities. They come in handy sometimes and others not so much. We all have fears. And that's what insecurities are. That's where worry comes from. Judgment, even in a lot of cases, just dislike. It's, you know, it all stems from fear. We are all scared. I'm clearly here to make you feel upbeat about things. Hopefully none of you are listening to me while you jog. I don't know if I'm the best jogging voice. So, I don't know. We do. We're all scared. Every one of us has four or five things right now that scares them. That's my bet. I can think of like 10 of mine right now. Fear, it can motivate us, it can slow us down, it can stop us completely. I think about fear and what drives human decisions quite a bit. Creating characters as, you know, a way of bringing home the bacon, or at least attempting to, makes paying attention to details part of the gig of being me and doing what I do. And this one character I've been spending a lot of time on recently working on her. Her name is Elliot Granger, and she's the protagonist of my serial. I officially kick off this Friday after working on it for a while and kicking it around. It was actually going to get posted. The full thing was going to get posted last week, but last week was a week, that's for sure. But yeah, so Elliot Granger and the Clueless Brigade will post this Friday on the Scribbler. And she is afraid of the world and struggling with grief and knows she needs to pull her shit together. She's just not quite sure how. She has the habit of taking pictures of interactions instead of having them herself. And the other side of that is I have Ruby, who is afraid of herself. Her power is so great that Ruby has trouble trusting herself, and this makes having relationships difficult. And then my other protagonist, Samantha, in the YA contemporary I'm pitching currently, she's scared of becoming like her mother, and she's terrified of not being successful. Even more so, she's scared to death of being alone. So back to that, we all have fears to overcome, and I think there is truth. I think more truth in our culture, you know, would help all of us accept that and talk about it. You know, often fear or, you know, being scared of something is, you know, it tends to be something that people want to hide. But really, we're all afraid and we're all nervous. And that's, you know, that's something. Of course, you know, all different people, all different fears, different ways of coping with them. You know, the strange thing about fear that fascinates me is how it can sometimes be something that it entices us. The whole horror genre, whether it be books, TV, movies, comics, video games, you know, really speaks to that desire to feel free fear and how fear helps us. It means we're alive. You know, Walking Dead is a really good example from that, because that show scares me. It gets my blood pumping. And, you know, as the seasons progress and I get more and more attached to the characters, I care about them some of them quite a bit. And like last week, I was on the edge of the sofa the whole time. I was nervous, and yet I wanted more. And like the season finale coming up, I'm nervous about it, but I also want to know what happens. And you know, that fear, that uncertainty. Before I go on any more about The Walking Dead and all things scary, I'm going to bring Rob onto the show. Let's bring him on. Hey, Robert. Thank you. And welcome to the show. Thank you for coming on.
Well, thanks, Jayme. I'm glad. I'm very happy to be introduced into my very first podcast. A little nerve-wracking, kind of, but at least it isn't live.
I get nervous before I talk to myself and get ready to record with just myself, so I'm nervous too.
Right on the phone. Exactly. So, but I'm really appreciate you inviting me to the podcast. I'm really excited to be a part of this, and it kind of gets my feet wet, you know, with the whole podcast thing too. So, but listen to one of your other, I would listen to your first one. I was really enjoyed
That's
it.
That's awesome. Yeah. You know, before I had you on, I was just talking about fear and, you know, how it drives us and motivates us. And, you know, and I was talking about how as writers, we need to think about that. And which just naturally took me into The Walking Dead, because as far as playing in on fears and, you know, the writers there have a full-time job with, you know, the fears of their characters. And it took me right there. And I honestly, I will take any excuse to talk about that show.
Right. I hear you.
Well, and I saw, you know, your post a couple of weeks ago, which led you to be on here, was, you know, you were talking about The Walking Dead. And so I'm assuming you're all caught up and you're ready for the season finale.
Yeah, the 90-minute season finale. And spoiler alert, I don't know if we're gonna, you know, I tried it, you know, we're gonna be talking about The Walking Dead, so I'm personally gonna try not to, you know, spoil anything for anybody who may not be caught up in the series yet. But last week was interesting.
Well, you know, so I think what we can, at this point, I think we can, there's spoilers.
Well, yeah, but spoiler alert for anybody who's listening, so.
Yeah. Spoiler alert, we're going to be talking about The Walking Dead, and, yeah, so if you haven't seen, if you're not caught up to date, you are going to get spoiled, and, here we go. So I'm very upset. I don't know exactly the extent of the blood and who it belongs to, but
yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know if you watched the Talking Dead afterwards.
I did. Yep.
Okay, so I mean, as far as what Chris said about that, I think it's pretty obvious that that was Daryl's blood. I mean, so I can't see how it could be anybody else's, unless they do something crazy like they do with Glenn.
See, you know? There is always that possibility.
There's always that possibility. I don't think, I mean, I'm almost positive. I feel like 99% positive. He's okay. I mean, he's not dead. You know,
I mean, I agree with that.
And I mean, that would, I, you know, I'm afraid that eventually he's probably gonna die later on in the series. That's a risk for them to do that. It'd be like, you know, for me, you know, like with Michonne, if they ever kill off Michonne, I'm going to be pissed, you know. But I watch Game of Thrones too, so I'm kind of used to stuff like that. So, and I still watch the show, even though I'm so upset with George R. R. Martin, you know, from the last season. But anyway, yeah. Back to The Walking Dead.
Well, it is hard to, I mean, I will be really upset. I mean, he is my favorite character. I do think I'll still watch the show. I mean, I love the show.
Absolutely. You're not a you're not a fan of the show if a main character dies and then you stop watching the show.
No, no. I mean, I will still watch it, but I will be very upset.
Yeah, I would too. You know, I think this has probably been, I think for me, the best season out of the whole series so far. That's just me personally. I don't know if any others would agree, but I think particularly the B season of this season. It's just, I mean, starting from the first episode of this second half of the season was just phenomenal. I was afraid that, okay, we've just had this, you know, this just crazy first opening episode for the second half of the season. They say, okay, we got all the action and craziness out. Now they're going to go back to the Waltons, you know?
You know, so. Well, that's been their format lately. I mean,
yeah, but they didn't do it this time. It's been really, you know, really intense throughout the entire second half of the season. I'm very pleased with that.
I am too. And I agree with you, actually. I really liked season two, but this season, as far as like, every time I tune in, I feel like I'm getting what I want.
Yeah.
As far as like the action and the drama, and there isn't like a whole episode about just some random character that I wasn't expecting, or like, you know, I'm right. Stuck in governor land.
Right. You know, I mean, I understand why they do that. It gives a nice explanation of the backstory of the character and what they did with the governor. And they also do that with Morgan, which I actually really liked. Some people didn't like that.
Well, with Morgan, I love.
Yeah, I think
was really interesting.
It really explains why he is the way he is, and mm-hmm. why he believes about, you know, he doesn't want to kill anybody. And there's a reason why. And that episode really explained the mentality of Morgan's character, of why he is the way he is. With that said, I think he's really gotten to Carol, which has kind of really upset me because, you know, she's one of my favorite characters, and I hate where her character's kind of arcing. You know, it's like she was like a really badass, and now she's like struggling with the whole, you know, having to kill others, and of course this last episode she just wow.
I know, and you know, and it's been frustrating me too, because as the fact that Daryl is my favorite character,
right,
I'm watching this and I'm like, she is making terrible decisions, her mind is a mess, and it's gonna get Daryl killed because he really cares about her.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Now, it turns out, I guess, that he's on the road for, you know, Denise and not Carol, which is, you know, not what I was expecting, you know.
Well, I mean, Daryl, I mean, he's just, he has a lot of emotional, and he's his particular character, you know, he's, well, first of all, he was kind of a loner.
Yeah, his part gets him in trouble.
Yeah, and, but in this last episode, I mean, it's like, there was just a lot of mistakes several of the characters are making. It's like, okay, Daryl takes off, and then half the rest of the group decides, well, they're going to take off after him, and now we got a big mess.
Uh-huh. I know.
Which makes great TV.
Yes.
It just pisses us off. It's like, what are you doing? After you just went through, and you're finally safe back in, you know, Alexandria, and now you're going to go out again? Uh-huh. You know? So.
Yeah, but, and like all the heavy hitters. I mean, not all of them, but a fair amount of them are not in Alexandria.
The main ones, yeah. And then poor Maggie and Glenn keep getting split apart. Like every time we turn around, it's like they get back together, and then now they're, you know, one or the other gets captured. Now it's Glenn again. You know, it's like, jeez.
Yeah. Well, and she cut her hair, so she's getting ready to do something crazy.
Yeah, and then you got the whole at the very end of the episode with I'm thinking she's having a miscarriage. And I was actually joking about this with my mom, who's also a big fan of the show. I was like, you know, I was like, when somebody dies, they're automatically become walkers.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I'm thinking, okay, she's got a baby inside of her. It's going to die. It's going to become a walker. It's going to, you know, just kind of use your imagination. But
I honestly didn't even think about that.
But, I don't think that's where they're heading, but you know, it's, you know, if I were writing, I'd probably go crazy, something like that, and whatever.
Yeah.
But,
huh.
But yeah, so, but I think she's probably going to lose the baby.
And hopefully
that's the least of her concerns.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was wondering how they were going to handle that, because of course they had to handle it different than when Lori got pregnant. They couldn't do the same thing.
Yeah, so. Exactly.
I know. I think about this show sometimes, like, you know, being a writer, that is a lot to handle.
Oh man, it's just I mean the writers of The Walking Dead, I mean, they're just unbelievably talented. I mean, I can only dream of being able to write like that. I mean, it's just they're just really I mean, and there's several different writers and the directors and Nick, you know, I mean, just everything about the you know, that evolves around, you know, all the cast and the crew and everything that put the show together is just amazing talent.
I love it.
Just the writers. I mean, obviously it's, you know, it's based on the comic, which I have to admit, I've never read the comics. I mean, I'm not really a big comic fan, but, so I, you know, I know that's a sin, but you know,
you know, I've read a few, I haven't read all of it because there's so much, right. But it's very different. The show is very different.
Yeah. And I'm glad it is.
Characters. I mean, you know, in the comic book, spoiler alert, Shane was dead in like 3 pages.
Right. And, you know, and you talk about how you know, shows that are based on other, you know, on novels or comics or short stories, wherever, you know, Stephen King is obviously my favorite, you know, he's my favorite writer. But, you know, like, for example, Under the Dome, which the show kind of stunk. But I don't know if you watched Under the Dome, the series.
No, I haven't.
But, you know, I read the book. The book was really good. I mean, his character development is just excellent. Then I watched Under the Dome. So I was really excited when Under the Dome came out. But then, you know, keeping in line with the differences of characters in a series versus what the original work was, from the very first episode of Under the Dome, it was just completely different. I can already tell there was a difference because one particular character was killed off like right away, you know, in the book. And in the series, that character kind of lasted for several, I mean, I think like two seasons, I think. And so, you know, that's where, you know, I'm kind of comparing, you know, with the comic books and the TV show Walking Dead. But that's great because for people who have already read the comics or have read the book based on a show, I mean, the show based on a book, you're getting a different experience, you know.
I personally
like that.
Well, yeah. And I mean, it's to be expected because you have a different medium. So there's different ways that, you know, you're, you know, accustomed to handling things. But it's also you have different creatives on the team. So
exactly.
There's going to be differences. There's going to be, you know, it's natural to want to make a difference.
Right.
And
also it's like, you know, people who are fans of the comic books and fans of the show. I mean, that, you know, people who watch, who've read the comics and are now watching the show, there's opportunities for them to be surprised.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and so in a sense, I kind of wish I had read the comics to get that experience. But eventually when I eventually do go and read the comics, it's still going to be a different experience. So I'll recognize certain things from the show, but, you know, reading the comics, will be, or graphic novels and, depending on, you know, it's not, you know, I guess it's the politically correct way of, you know, it's, you know, saying comic books and the graphic novels of Walking Dead, the interesting experience, you know, after watching the show, which is, I kind of like watching the shows first and then reading the books.
I honestly feel, I wish I did that because like, I got so into it. I was just like, okay, well, you know, I wanted more. It was like, I was like off season. I think it was like, I was between, I had just watched season, the first and second season, and I was waiting for the third season.
Right.
And I started reading them. And honestly, I think, you know, if I could go back and just watch the show all the way through and then do the comics, I think I would. Because mm-hmm. then, you know, I'll be like excited for the next episode. And I don't like spoilers, not when it comes to Walking Dead. And
yeah.
I'll be on Twitter and somebody's like, oh, it's true to the comic, or, you know, this storyline is against the comic. And there it is. There's my spoiler. I'm like, ah. And it's not always the case. You know, I'll watch a show expecting to be spoiled and I'll be like, oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, it's like, you know, when I watch The Talking Dead afterwards, you know, Chris kind of spoils certain things because I, you know, he's obviously read the comics and then he talks about, oh, this character, he's, you know, I can't wait till this character shows up on the show because he's based on such and such. Like, gee, thanks, you know.
Yeah.
But he doesn't, you know, he does it in a way that doesn't really spoil the show because, you know, I mean, he's just saying that this particular character is in the comic and this is what his character is, but it doesn't really go, and he doesn't go any further than that. So that's okay. I give him a pass for that, but still.
Yeah. No. I know with all this talk about the big bad this season, you know, there's a lot of the way it was in the comic, the way it wasn't in the comic, you know, speculations, and all I'm like is just keep Daryl alive.
Yeah. And then when Morgan and Rick were, you know, at the barn, when they're looking for Carol, mm-hmm. and that particular character, that guy that ran away, that Rick is reminding me a lot of Shane. you know, from the first right? season. Like, you know, he's like, you know, oh, he's moving, you know, just kill him, you know. Just like, you know, shoot first and ask questions later. It's like, man. Yeah, Grick's character has changed quite a bit.
It's true. I feel like it's a realistic change, but like for a few seasons there, he's constantly like, that's not who we are.
Yeah, and you understand why he's like that now, because it's like he's been burned so many times. It's like, I'm not taking any more risks.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I don't know this guy. He's probably a part of a larger group. And it's like, you know what? And he's running away. He's going down.
Yeah.
You know?
Totally. Well, and his forgiveness has been, yeah, like you said, it's come back so many times that, like,
yeah.
I get that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's come back to body, and people have died because of it, literally.
No, you know, yeah.
Of him being, you know, kind of soft and trusting people. And now he doesn't trust anybody, which in that world, that is how you survive, by not trusting anybody, you know?
Yeah, or being, you know, definitely being very selective about who you let in. I mean, look at, you know, Daryl, what he's dealing with, and, you know, that guy that took his bike and now has apparently made him bleed all over the camera.
Yeah, yeah. So, I kind of saw that was a big mistake when he let them go the first time. And I was like, that's going to come back and bite him. And sure enough, you know, I didn't expect that.
I feel like they are going to kill some important people, though. I feel like that's coming.
It's long overdue, I think. You know, they've gone through, I mean, they've killed some, you know, kind of minor characters that but as far as the major characters, I think we're probably, if not the season opener, or shortly thereafter. But, you know, let's just kind of cross our fingers and hope that doesn't happen. But eventually it's going to happen.
It is. Well, we haven't. I mean, Beth was pretty significant.
And how she died, you know, it's
gosh.
Kind of foolish the way I think. It's like, well, you know what?
That made me mad.
Yeah. That was pretty hard. But after everything she went through, then for her to go out like that.
Yeah, right in front of everybody.
Right. And, you know, it kind of brings me back to Daryl, because Daryl really cared about Beth, and then he sees her get killed, and then, you know, and then somebody else, you know, what's her name? The doc.
Yeah.
You know, she gets killed by his own crossbow.
Yeah. That's a
good. You know, so I think that really hit him hard. And so, unfortunately, now they're in the mess that they're in. And it looks like Negan is from the very, very end of the last episode, this whole Negan thing is which I don't know who or what Negan really is since I haven't read the comics. But looks like we're going to get some more answers for those who haven't read the comics on Sunday. So I'm looking forward to that.
I am too. Apparently he has a pretty awesome weapon in his hands, according
to. Yeah.
I hear his voice and then I see a weapon that I just really hope doesn't touch any of our characters, though it probably will.
Right. So. But we'll see what happens.
Yes, we will. I'm looking forward to it, but I'm also nervous. But so I am currently reading Devil's Nightmare, and I'm on chapter 17, Confessions. I'm not into the chapter yet. I've just gotten there, and I am loving it.
Great, great. I'm glad to hear that.
It's very right away. I'm very engaged. And I see that you have a second one out.
Yes, Premonitions is, and you know, funny thing is Premonitions actually, Devil's Nightmare, the one that you're reading right now, was originally supposed to be a standalone novel.
Okay.
So, after I published Devil's Nightmare, it was my first, pardon the pun, stabbing horror. But it was my first, you know, my first try at writing horror, and I've always wanted to write horror. And so I figured, why not? Let's try it. And when I wrote Devil's Nightmare, you know, if it's in first person, it's from the perspective of the main character, Detective Aaron Sanders. Huh. And so after I, you know, finished that one, I published myself. Originally self-published it before I was republished through Book Tropes horror imprint Forsaken. And it did better than I anticipated. So I was very pleased that you know. After the first initial people that I knew were reading it and liked it, and then when you start hearing from total strangers that they've enjoyed what you've written, That's always encouraging as an author. I'm sure you know that.
Yeah. And the reviews and everything on Devil's Nightmare, it's positive. It's
got some negative too.
People are always.
But yeah, it's predominantly positive. But you know, which I think is it's a good thing that there are some negative reviews in there and makes it more real.
Yeah.
You know, because you hear about people say, oh, you know, those you know indie authors, they just you know. It's just a bunch of family and friends that post those 5 and 4 star reviews. And, you know, when you have a balance of, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 star reviews, it, you know, kind of makes it more real. And, but yeah, like but, for us, you know, and I don't mind the negative reviews. Some are kind of funny, you know, and I learned from some of them too. You know, when a lot of the more negative ones come from my earlier version of Devil's Nightmare, which is my self-published version prior to publishing with Booktrope under their Forsaken imprint, because originally my very first edition, which was self-published, I didn't actually have an editor, which is, as we all know, is a big no-no. So once I had, Carolyn Ritter, Aspen Ritter, she's my editor for Devil's Nightmare books and she did a phenomenal job. I learned a lot from her and, the version that you're reading now, the Forsaken version is so much better, you know, because of it. And, so I've been very pleased, with the feedback that I've gotten from my readers. I love interacting with my readers and talking about the book and talk about the characters, things that they like, things that they don't like, you know. And particularly with once you get to the second book, is a bit darker than okay. Devil's Nightmare. If some people think Devil's Nightmare itself is dark enough, but it does. It does get a little darker, and I actually switched to perspective to third person because based on some feedback from my readers, they wanted to learn more about certain characters like Cody, for example. They wanted to learn more about him, but since the first book is written from Aaron's perspective, there's right. you learn more about Aaron than you do about other characters because it's from his perspective, and so I wrote it. The second book in third person in order to dive in a little bit more into the lives of the other characters that make it to the second book. So but yeah, it was Devil's Nightmare was a lot of fun to write. I wrote
like it would have been like and that brings me to a question that I have.
Okay.
Because it's an intense story, and I know from writing the highly capable and dealing with Ruby, you know, what it's like to handle the darker storyline and getting into those kind of, you know, intense places. And, mm-hmm. you know, was that something that you, you know, had to work up to or like?
There were some parts were hard, harder to write than others. But yeah, get into the, I've enjoyed horror all my life, so I mean, as far as getting into the really dark stuff, I mean, it doesn't really bother me all that much. But certain things, particularly with the second book, there were some things that were kind of hard because some scenes were based on actual things that I went through in my life as a teen. And so I kind of course, I fictionalize everything.
Right.
And most of, you know,
the emotion and the...
I'm sorry?
I was going to say, sorry. Like, you know, some of the emotion and stuff is what you...
Right. Exactly. You know, the second book, there's a little bit of bullying that's thrown into the story. And so I touch on that a little bit. And I don't want to give any spoilers or anything, but it affected me on a personal level because I was bullied as a kid. And so it gave me the opportunity to kind of write that into the story without it, you know, and turn it into... In a horror, you know, in put some horror elements into
right.
it.
So. No, well, it can,
and, which was a lot of fun.
Yeah, totally. Well, it can, you know, as a writer, a lot of just, you know, real emotion, it comes through and you know, when you're writing fiction, it comes through in different ways. And, yes. But yeah, it's true. Some scenes are definitely or some characters or some issues are, you know, definitely harder than others. And
yeah, and Aaron's kind of you know, he's in certain ways he's kind of cliched in certain aspects. You know, it's kind of hard, you know, to write horror without having any cliches in it. I mean, it's just, you know, it's kind of impossible, but, so there are some, you'll find some, and I'm sure you've already pointed some out, but as a character and stuff, you know, he's, you know, like kind of the whole loner type deal, you know, the lone gunman type thing, but you know, he's kind of a jerk at times, you know, but there's reasons that's why.
Real. That's real, though. I mean,
and that's, you know, and I'm glad you've recognized that, because he's a broken character. He really is. He's got a lot of imperfections, and that's kind of one of the things I really liked about Aaron, and writing it from his perspective. I mean, there are some elements of me in his character,
sure.
That I've experienced, but you know, not a whole lot, but. But he's flawed, but, I think, you know, as he progresses to the end of the story, he does make a little bit of changes, but he's still a flawed character. And I think that's the way it needs to be for him. But, in book two, you know, you'll find some, you know, there's some more, you know, things that he has to deal with, but, some of the other characters also, I mean, there's, you know, some characters, you know, you love and you love to hate, you know, there's, you know, I have my personal favorites that I love to hate, and particularly in book two, that I really love to hate, and I took care of them. and contrary to anybody's, you know, no, none of my characters are based on real people. So just none of them are. So don't, you know, that's you know, so I didn't kill off people that are based on other people, although I did think about it. So, but yeah.
I think it's so important to have flawed characters. And I mean,
it is.
And sometimes, I mean, like Ruby, the protagonist for The Highly Capable, she is incredibly flawed. Mm-hmm. That is, you know, she's riddled in flaws and shortcomings. And there are some, you know, people who I think wish that she would be, you know, more put together and less frustrating. But, you know.
But that's not realistic, though.
No, it's not. I think everybody is flawed and frustrating.
Yeah. I mean, it's like we could always write our characters and just be these perfect, you know, characters that have absolutely no flaws and they do everything right and they don't make mistakes and they're just lovable, completely lovable. But that's not realistic. And that's, to me personally, that's kind of boring. You know, yeah. I like, you know, having characters and reading about characters that have issues. And sometimes they deal with them. Sometimes they don't. And that's okay, I think. Me personally.
No, absolutely.
Others may not agree, but that's just me, you know. I mean, I write for myself first before I actually don't write to a particular audience. I write for myself first and then, you know, hopefully, you know, if people enjoy what I write, that's icing on the cake. So but thankfully, you know, looks like there are people that haven't actually enjoyed the story. So
it looks like there's been a lot of people. You seem to have a really strong following and a really strong amount of people that really like that. And I gotta say why. I really am enjoying it. And the voice and the description, it's really strong.
I'm pleased to hear that. Thank you. But I mean, it's you know, and I struggled actually when I wrote the first draft. It was actually in third person.
Really?
The original first. The story actually changed because I had actually started writing this story years ago, and then it was originally going to be, you know, the premise, the whole idea of it is kind of pretty much the same, but the characters changed, the plot changed, and of course the perspective changed. And the reason I decided to change it from third person to first person for this book. Was because, one, I didn't write it with an outline. I completely wrote it, you know, as a pantser. You know, I knew where it was going.
Right.
But I wrote it completely without an outline, late at night, you know, so I was just,
fun.
And yeah, it was a lot of fun. And writing it from first person, it helped me to be able to pull out, since it's kind of a blend of mystery and horror and thriller and cop drama, you know, there's kind of a blend of genres in the story, but the mystery aspect to it, I think it was easier for me to write and more enjoyable for me to write in first person because I only knew what was going on, and I discovered things as Aaron discovered them, yes, as he was investigating the case, mm-hmm, you know, with Cody and all the other stuff that I'm not going to give any spoilers, but all the other crazy stuff that's going on, including a certain, you know, supernatural creature element, which is about as far as I'll say, but yeah, so that, I think that, and I think it worked, you know, had I written it in third person, I think I would have lost that particular element. In the second book, it does work because of the idea of bringing in a little more information about the other characters. But that's why I did switch it to first person on the first book.
It is interesting how, you know, first and third can just make such a difference. I past and current, I started writing The Highly Capable started as, 6 years ago was The Adventures of Miss Mindshift that I self-published, and it has come a long way since then. But it is, when you're telling a story with first person, you're very focused on how, you know, it's affecting your protagonist, what your protagonist thinks. But third person, you have such a, you know, I'm currently just writing a third person book for the first time. And
yeah, and I actually find third person is actually harder to write.
It is.
I think it is harder because I think in first person, because it is, to me, I think it's like when you're writing in first person, you feel a little closer to the character, to the main character, and they become, you know, it's almost like building kind of a relationship with that character. I mean, in author speak, you know, people, you know, if you're an author, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
exactly. And, you know, but you know, when you have that really close relationship with that character, then you kind of, I think it's a lot easier to kind of, you know, understand and figure out why or what they're going to do next. And then you're able to apply that and put it into words for the readers on paper or digital format in this case, on most cases.
Yeah. It is interesting it's such a journey to kind of climb into the world and the mind. And then you go through so much to like translate that, to get that to a point where other people can read it. And it's always interesting because like sometimes, you know, when I hear, you know, what somebody thinks of something, it's interesting because it's often very different than what I've thought about it.
Right, right, exactly. And I think that it really is. It's like, and you know, you bring that point. It's like, you know, when we write characters, particularly our main characters, we pretty much know who they are, what their flaws, what their character traits are. And when we write it, you know, it's like, but when you hear from your readers, like you said, I mean, they have a completely different idea of what that character, who that character is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe what he looks like or what she looks like or you know, why she or what she may have done or what she should have done, or you know what, I don't think he would do that.
Uh-huh.
You know, because and I love it when I hear stuff like that from readers, because you really learn something about yourself as a writer, but as about your characters themselves, because we're too attached to them and to our stories. And when you really got to step back and, you know what, because I know a lot of authors, new and old, you know, people that have been published, you know, independently, traditionally, and been writing, you know, 12, 13, you've got, you know, a lot of books, or maybe written the first book. But with the one common thing that we've all gone through is when a reader or a reviewer says something negative about a character or your book, and then the first thing that happens is you get defensive.
Uh-huh.
You know, and this is coming, you know, I don't do it anymore, but you know, when we first start writing, you know, you're like, oh no, they don't know what they're talking about.
Oh my gosh, you know, no one could say anything to me.
But most of the time they're absolutely right. You know, because they're not attached. They don't have such an attachment to that character like you do. They tend to really understand them more, I think, than you do, because they don't have that emotional attachment to that character. You know, so
they're looking from the outside in. They're taking the facts and the traits that they see and putting their opinion together. Whereas,
yeah, exactly. And when your character does something that they don't think, you know what, that's completely out of character, that he wouldn't do that. That's just, you know, that's not something he would do, you know? And so like, particularly with my beta readers, you know, when I send out, you know, the initial copies, like in Devil's Nightmare,
right.
when I sent out to my beta readers, I mean, I learned a lot about my characters, you know, from their perspective. In book two, I learned a lot of things that I, you know, book two, I made a lot of changes after the beta read. one particular change I had to, it was like I had to completely change an entire scene because I thought it was perfect and I thought it made sense and it was right. But then I'm not going to say what it is or even kind of, you know, with fear of, you know, spoiling anything, but
right.
basically she said that, you know, you really need to change this because, you know, this, this, and this, and this. And I was like, at first I stepped back and said, you know what, you know, she doesn't understand. But then I'm like, you know what? She's right. You know, if I leave this in, that's going to cause problems, you know, it's going to lose some of my readers. Mm-hmm. You always lose the risk of losing readers if they don't agree or that you upset them. I can only imagine, you know, like George R.R. Martin is like, you know, when he kills off a main character or whatever, you know, oh my God, I'm never going to read, you know, I'm never going to watch Game of Thrones or read Game of Thrones ever again, but they always do, you know, because they love the series, you know, and that's kind of where, you know, when we write certain things in our books and, you know, whether sometimes it's really hard, particularly when you kill off a character.
Yeah.
It's really hard when you do that. I mean, it's like, whether it's a minor character or a main character but sometimes it's necessary.
And sometimes And sometimes, you know, there's no other way to go about it.
Exactly.
You know, so what you were talking about with having to go back and changing something, you know, for the greater good of your book, I had a whole character arc between two characters, two pretty prevalent, you know, it was a pretty big deal. And I was told, you know, that, you know, it took away from, you know, something else and to look at it this way. And at first I was just like, what? And then, you know, in the middle of the night, probably I was like, okay, yeah, you know, we need to make this happen.
Yeah. And it's really hard to get that type of feedback because, you know, when you write that story, you're like, oh man, it's the best story. You know, it's going to be a bestseller. You know, we're writers. Every writer thinks that they've got the best idea and everybody's going to love it, you know? And then we get our beta readers and our advanced review readers. And then they, you know, take us out of the clouds and back to earth, you know, and realize that we're not right, you know? And then you learn things, you know, yeah. So sometimes, you know, I mean, you've heard the expression, you know, sometimes you have to kill your darlings. And I think Stephen King's the one that actually said that. But anyway, so that's true. You know, sometimes you absolutely have to cut things out or change things that you think is right for your story. But after getting the feedback, it turns out that it's not. And it's really hard to hit that delete key, you know, and you put so much effort into writing that scene, or sometimes you have to cut out an entire chapter. Uh-huh. Or even remove an entire, you know, a character, you know, yep. from the story.
I once had to make a decision that took 20,000 words away.
Yeah, that's a lot. A lot. That's almost as painful as losing your computer crashing and losing your manuscript. It's almost painful. Maybe not as painful, but yeah, I mean, it's close.
Well, it was definitely, yeah, it was first like, okay, I agree with you, let's do this. And then it was like, oh, wow. Well, now we need to find 23,000
words. Right. I mean, 20,000 words. Sometimes that's a lot. That's a lot of work. You know, I mean, I'm not the, when I write, you know, I'm not the, for one thing, I'm not the fastest reader in general, but then, you know, when I write, I tend to take my time. And so, writing 20,000 words, that's a lot of time and effort.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah. And particularly if you've gone through and edited all that, you know, and several different drafts.
This was feedback from my, this was a decision that I made with my content editor. So it wasn't quite at the beta reader phase.
Right. Okay.
But yeah, no, and it takes me a long time to chew through words too. I did, NaNoWriMo month, in November.
I did that too. Yeah.
Yes, I think I remember. And that really highlighted.
For people who don't know what NaNoWriMo month is, it's basically a challenge to write 50,000 words in a month. And they promoted it as writing a novel in a month. I mean, 50,000 words is, you know, it's kind of a short novel, but I tend to go over 100,000 words in my stories. So it was like, you know, maybe a first draft, but yeah,
I mean, around 60. So that,
yeah, that so was that's a good size. Yeah. And actually what I did on National Novel Writing Month is I'm actually writing a short story collection that I'm giving away. Actually, the first story of my collection I've given away to my newsletter subscribers. And for early newsletter subscribers, they're getting the entire book.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so that's why I actually said, you know what, this is a good time to actually work on that so I can give something to my subscribers for free. Thanking them for being subscriber and is instead of subscribing. So the early guy, the people who have already signed up for it, you got a treat because you're getting the whole book. You know, new subscribers are you know, there are other incentives, but you'll get the first. It was supposed to be a short story. It turned out to be a novelette. It was a novella because it's like over 30,000 words. So I mean, it's not really a short story, but that's the first story in the collection. So that was a good chunk of the month of writing was that first story, and it's gonna be a collection of five stories for the final product. So, but yeah, that novel National Novel Writing Month, it's a great way to get us disciplined.
Yes,
to writing every day, and 1600, you know, it's like 1667 words, I think, is the target for every day. You know, to reach that 50,000 mark, and it's hard, especially when you have a really busy schedule and. It's not easy.
No, it's not. And you know what? And it for some reason didn't click on me. It didn't click with me like exactly how many words a day until I was like a week and a half into it. And I at that point only did, I don't know, like 3,000 words. And I read somewhere. I was like, oh, yeah.
Remember that for next. But even if you don't reach that goal of less the 1,667 a day, I mean, the whole point of the challenge is to get you writing every day, whether it's 300 words, 400 words, 100 words. It's just getting you in the habit of working on your story every single day.
I learned so much. It's so true. And I learned so much that month. Just think, you know, because it's true. It did really get me in the habit. And I ended up doing a pretty solid first draft there. So
yeah. And another thing that I learned, because I did it last year also, or 2014. I also did it in 2014. That was the first time I participated in it. And that in 2014, it was actually, I wrote the 50,000 words. It's actually book three of the Devil's Nightmare series, and which was originally going to be published last year. But then I had that deal with BookTrope and got the deal with BookTrope. So that actually, you know, it pushed it back about a year. So I'll be working on that later this summer.
Nice.
But anyway, so. When one thing I learned about the process of writing in the challenge is to not focus on your edit, because I'm really bad at editing while I'm writing. And this year or in 2015, I was a lot better at just getting words down. I mean, I wasn't focusing on, you know, sentence structure, just getting the story down.
Yeah.
You know, misspellings, or even if I'm stuck in the middle of a scene, it's like, well, I don't know exactly what to write, but I have a general idea, then write that down and move on. That's the point of the challenge. Because if you don't, then you're just gonna sit there and stare at the screen for, you know, 45 minutes, you know, and not get anything done. You know. So because you can always go back in and add that stuff in later.
It's so true. I get caught up sometimes with just over editing what I write as I write it. And I can't remember where I heard this quote, but it's or even if it's like the exact quote, but something that you can't edit what isn't written. And it's
so right. True. Right. Yeah. I just
think there's variations of it.
There's variations, but I just saw that not too long ago, and I,
you probably
I can't, for the life of now, it's going to be bothering me. I'm going to have to look it up later now. So, but yeah, I know exactly which quote you're talking about.
Yeah.
But now it's just going to bother me.
I'm
going to have to look it after we get off this podcast. I have to look it up. You know, it's like.
It's going to bother me.
Yeah, who they're originally like, thank God for Google.
like Monday or something. And I was like, yeah, totally.
Right, right. So.
So I've heard you. You said it earlier. And then I've also read it in, you know, because I've been, you know, looking at your blog and other things. that you've been a horror fan for lots and lots of years. What are some of the earlier, like, what do you consider ones that you hold, you know, near and dear to your heart?
Oh, wow. Well, pretty much anything written by Stephen King. Stephen King is pretty much my favorite. I mean, as far as horror novels, I mean, he is pretty much, I'm reading a lot of indie stuff, particularly people are, you know, from the Forsaken group, fellow authors in Forsaken Book Tropes, horror imprint, but I'm starting to read a lot of that. But originally, Stephen King is pretty much where a lot of my, you know, horror fandom comes from is everything that he's written, you know, from the adaptations of into movies but you know, reading his actual work, of course, is always so much better. But Creepshow is actually, if I want to go back as far as the first time I remember a horror movie or the horror genre in general, it's got to go back to, and it's going to sound cheesy, but Friday the 13th is my first memory of horror. It's Friday the 13th, you know, and you know, now, I mean, I watch them as an adult now. It's like, these are so stupid, but they're fun to watch, you know, but back then, you know, and why on earth my parents let me watch that movie as a kid, I have no idea, but you know, here I am today, you know, writing horror. So whatever. So I guess that's a good thing.
Yeah. Well,
but yeah, I mean, just that was my first memory of really getting scared. And this is that last scene where Jason, you know, the kid jumps out of the water and pulls that, the last final survivor into the water. That scared the crap out of me. My next memory that I can remember that really scared the crap out of me was Cujo. And there's for several reasons. One, when Stephen King wrote, I mean, when Stephen King's, horror novel and movie Cujo, I mean, the thing that's really scary, that was scary for me, was because it wasn't a monster. Okay. It was a real life thing. This could really happen type deal. You know, this dog gets rabies and this big St. Bernard just goes on, you know, just on this killing spree. And this is real. This could really happen. You know, that's what made it so scary, you know. But then there's, you know, those jump, you know, when he jumps through that window at the end and just, you know, right at the end, of that just scared the crap out of me. It's like, okay, you know, the dog's dead. And then, no, he's not. He jumps through the window and, you know.
Yeah, that was pretty scary.
But yeah, I mean, Stephen King's early work, like, you know, that Cujo and Friday the 13th are my earliest memories of what really that I remember of being kind of my favorites, and Creepshow, of course. Creepshow is probably my favorite. You know,
it's funny how those earlier, like some of the earlier, you know, impressions of things, just like, you know, they stay with you.
Yeah, and I like I really like the older stuff. I mean, horror is kind of making a comeback in you know, in film and in writing. It's getting more popular. I haven't seen a lot of good as far as film. So I really love horror films, but I haven't seen a lot that I really liked that are coming out today. There are a few, but you know, things like The Thing, you know, stuff from the 80s, 70s and 80s, I think were probably the best ones, I think. That was, you know, there was a lot more practical horror. Now it's you know, when you talk about film, it's all kind of scare tactics, cheap scares, you know, with
a lot more sensationalized.
Yeah. And it's just like, you know, and then, you know, everything's CGI, computer generated, you know, and it's like, what I loved about the older horror films was everything was made with practical effects and it just seemed more real. Mm-hmm. I like good special effects, and it's like, you know, the special effects are a lot better with CGI if it's done well. But there's just something about practical effects that I really, really, really enjoy. But as far as the novels go, Stephen King is pretty much when I feel like reading something in traditional horror, it's usually Stephen King's, typically his older work. His newer stuff it's not as good as his older stuff, I think. You know, I still like reading pretty much anything that comes out with, but I think his older stuff is probably the best.
He's written so many at this point, hasn't he?
I don't know. I just don't know. I wish I can write like that. Oh my God. It's like pumping out. I have a hard time pumping out one in a year, 2 years. You know, he's pumping out, you know, 2-3 novels a year. I was like, how the heck does he do it? And then when he wrote, I think he wrote Dreamcatcher. I think he wrote that one longhand. It was after his accident when he got hit by the van. And I believe that's when he wrote Dreamcatcher. If I'm not mistaken, I think it was Dreamcatcher that he wrote that one. If you haven't read his memoir on writing, you have got to read that book. I mean, whether you're a writer or not, if you just enjoy Stephen King, that is the absolute. I mean, that's my favorite book that he's written. I mean,
I have not read this.
You have got to read that book. It is phenomenal. I mean, it's. I love his, it's a memoir, but he also talks about writing in general. And I love his no BS approach to his advice for writers. I mean, he doesn't, he doesn't sugarcoat anything. He's just very straightforward and just no BS. And
I love that.
But you learn. Yeah. You learn a lot about his, where he came from. I mean, his first, Carrie, when that was his first really big, that's kind of what launched his career was his novel, Carrie. Yeah. And, but it's very, very interesting. As a matter of fact, I'm planning on reading that one again. I mean, it's just, and that book is actually what inspired me to become an author.
That's awesome.
And, I always wanted to read something, but when I wrote my very first book, it was Pursuit of a Dream. It's kind of a contemporary, family oriented story,
BookBub, I believe.
Right. And so that was my very first novel that I wrote back when I was in between jobs. And I said, you know what? I'm going to write a book. And it's kind of a parallel. I mean, it's a good story. I enjoyed writing it. And people who have read it, it hasn't, not a lot of people have read it. But people who have read it have enjoyed it. But, I mean, it's completely different what I write now. But it's kind of a parallel of my dream of becoming an author. And, with this kid's dream of wanting to be a professional stock car driver. And so, but there's a lot of parallels between, his character and me personally as an author. And so
when I read the description of that or the summary of that story, I thought, oh, wow, I can relate to that as an author.
Yeah. And that's kind of, when I wrote it, that's kind of what I was hoping for. People who have read it. I mean, people who have read it kind of have gotten it, particularly if they're writers. And that's kind of what I was, and my goal was, it's like, this isn't really a story about auto racing as much as is it about a story about pursuing a dream, which is, the title is Pursuit of a Dream.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the title of the book. And, it hasn't really done well. I mean, of course, that was my very first book. I didn't write it to market the book at all. So it's out there. If you want to, get it, it's 99 cents. I mean, it's, I pretty much give it away, and it's not my best writing. It's my very first book. It's the self-published version. And, but it was a project of mine. I always wanted to write a novel and publish it, and I did. And that was kind of the thing. And then I ended up working at the newspaper and had started a career there. And so I didn't write anymore. And then once I left the newspaper back in 2013, that's when I decided I'm going to write another novel. And that's when, and that was after I read On Writing, which is really when I really, really got inspired to write, not only get more serious about writing novels, but more serious about trying to write in the horror genre. And so that's when I decided, I'm just going to do it. So that's not why I quit my job at the newspaper, but I took advantage of it. So, we parted ways, and I said, I'm on, here I am, and I have a side business also. So I had, some other things I was doing, but I said, I'm going to work from home. So I might as well do it. So spent the next year writing Devil's Nightmare, and we are where we are today. So, and like I said, it did. When I sold 100 books, I was thrilled.
Yeah.
You know,
well, that's a number to be thrilled about, I think.
It's a challenge, writing, particularly in the horror. It's horror genres. It's a hard genre to write in, yeah. and to market and or just any book. It's really hard to market. But I got lucky in a few instances when it hits a couple bestseller lists. Of course, 99 cents helped. So I didn't make a whole lot of money out of it, but it was just, that was not my goal. I mean, money, when I'm writing, it's not about the money. And if you're thinking about becoming an author and you're wanting to become an author to make money, you might want to rethink that.
It is a bit of a long road.
Yeah, you've got to really enjoy your craft. You really enjoy it. You know, that's it's my thing is writing, because I love to write stories and share it with others, and that's my first priority. And then if I make some money off it, that's great. You know, but that's not why I do it. And but anyway, so but yeah, it's been a very, very interesting and fun journey. Met a lot of, you know, very, very interesting people, and made some really great friends in the industry. You know, and then just, you know, and then signing with Book Trouble, you know, it's just been a real pleasure to work with, and I've learned a lot.
Yeah.
You know, people that I've worked with, very professional, just very, very, very nice and helpful people that I've met, you know, over the past few, several, you know, it's just really started getting really serious back in 2013. So over the past few years, a couple of years, you know, I've just, I've met some very, 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 very helpful and just, you know, the people, you know, in that are traditionally published and self-published, but it's the self-published authors, the indie authors, the ones that I relate with the most, obviously, because we're a very, very tight community. And, so it's just, I always enjoy seeing, when somebody decides they want to write their first book. And so I love talking to new authors because I'm still new, you know, but I've written a few books. And so I've kind of, you know, gotten little experience of the process. And it's always a pleasure to meet other authors that are just barely getting started.
It's comforting, isn't it? I mean,
to
talk to others and to meet others that are just in the same boat, you know, just trying to get the word out there, grinding it out. It's refreshing to talk to others and to see that, you know, you're not, what you're going through isn't necessarily all that
you're alone, you know. And, yeah. And one thing I always enjoy, you know, talking to new authors about is, you know, for one thing, it's very, very important to network and to really communicate with other authors, to join, you know, groups and to, you know, whether it's on social media or whatever, or at your local book club or whatever, just writing or local writing group, you've got to connect with other authors, because it is a very lonely profession.
It certainly can be, can't it?
And you can get, and it's so easy to get discouraged. I mean, because it's like, you spend, you know, when I, you know, like, you know, my first book, Pursuit of a Dream, you know, again, I didn't write it to publish, you know, to market it. It was just, you know, I wrote it to, so it'd be on my shelf, you know, that's why I wrote it, you know. But when I wrote Devil's Nightmare, I said, you know, I wrote it, I wanted to share it with the world. And, you know, now with technology and Kindle and Nooks and everything, you know, it's a lot easier to distribute, you know, books, you know, than it is with physical copies of books. Mm-hmm. But, I just lost my train of thought. But so, I mean, when I talk to authors, I tell them the importance of networking with other authors because of the challenges of going through the discouragement, because you spend sometimes 2, 3, 4, sometimes even 4 years working on a book.
Oh gosh. Yeah.
You know, I typically between 12 and 24 months for me, you know, because usually my novels are a little bit longer. You know, Devil's Nightmare is 115,000 words, I believe. And so when you spend, you know, 15, 18 months on a book, and then you finally launch it to the world, and then you're like, okay, you know, it's, you know,
it's out there.
Yeah, it's out there. You know, your beta readers loved it, you know, your friends loved it, your family members love it, the ones who actually read it.
Right. Yeah.
That's why. So when I talk and hear people, you know, when I articles about, oh yeah, they're just a bunch of family members, you know, writing those 5-star reviews. Little do they know, it's usually the family members are the hardest ones to get to read your book. Because most of them think you're nuts. Oh, it's just a hobby. Oh, that's nice. You wrote a book.
So true. No, it's like, yeah, fit in the, yeah. By the way, would you mind? Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
I'm blessed. My dad is about the only one who's read my book, you know, and he was like the last person I thought would read it. And he loved it. So I was like, that was great, you know? And, so that's like my one family member who's actually read it. So, anyway, but, the reason, it's so important, to network with other authors, because, you know, when you publish it and then you think, okay, great, you know, and then it doesn't sell.
Oh my God.
After all that work, I mean, it took, I think, for Devil's Nightmare, I think it was like 6 months. I went through it. It's like, I published, man, this is, you know, I'm all excited. I put it out on Kindle and, you know, I put it for 99 cents. It's like, I mean, it's only 99 cents. Who wouldn't buy it for 99 cents? And then crickets, you know?
Totally. No, it's crazy, especially the first time, like the first time experience, like all this work. And I mean, especially like, I mean, and it sounds similar. Like, I had no idea like what marketing entailed, what, you know, I wanted to write. I wanted to finish a book and I wanted to get it out there.
And yeah, that's the easy part.
Yeah, apparently, which, you know, yeah. It's not that easy to write a book. So,
yeah, it's just the whole process is like, once you write the book, you know, that's the quote unquote easy part. It's just, you know, that's not the end. You know, once it's, you know, once you hit published, now you've got to. How are you going to get it into reader? How are you going to get people to read it? You know, yeah. That's the hard part. It's very hard.
Got to write another one. Yeah.
Yeah. You just keep writing. And, you know, that's what I've learned. You know, of course, you know, when we first write our first book, you know, we put it out there and then we get discouraged. It's like, oh, nobody's reading it. Or then, you know, the few that actually do read it. And then you get your first 1-star review and that's just like totally devastating.
I know.
You know, oh my God, I suck. You know, I'm not going to do this anymore. I can't take it. You know, crawling, you know, in a corner, you know, and get in the fetal position and rock yourself to sleep, you know?
Totally. I know. House, just like shoveling cookies in my mouth. Like I'm a, no, it's hard. And I agree. It is tremendously important to, you know, connect with other writers and authors, and because it's isolating, you know, like you said, it takes a long time and you're putting all this time and energy and like, you know, mental strength into this. And then, yeah, you put it out. You're like, I did it. And then crickets.
Yep. Celebrate your victory of accomplishing that goal of writing and publishing your book. And then just, you know, try to market it and try to get it in people's hands, you know, learn and things you just do, read a lot. You know, and read the articles, the blogs, and talk to other authors. You know, it's like me. I have a friend of mine. His name is Michael Hicks, and he writes sci-fi. And,
that name sounds familiar.
Yeah, Michael. He's the author of the In Her Name series.
Okay.
Okay, so he's very, very, you know, very, very popular series in the science fiction genre.
It rang bells. And
sure. So okay, so, and, you know, shout out to Michael Hicks, and I'll send him his invoice later. but seriously, you know, he's I've learned a lot from him. And, so it's really important to, you know, to find somebody who has been successful. If you can find somebody like that. And once you do, you know, just, you know, build, you know, good relationships, not because of that, but if it's nice to have somebody that you can talk to, so that's actually been through it. He's written several books. And he's given me some pretty good advice about what to do, what not to do. And as far as marketing is concerned, Tim Grawl is another expert in marketing books that I highly recommend people to check out. There's so much information out there. And so much bad information out there.
Petri dish, isn't
it? Yeah, it's just that's one of the challenges of being an author, particularly an independently published author. If getting so much information and having to just getting that information overload, and because everybody has their opinions about what works and what doesn't work, everybody has their opinions about social media marketing, why you should do it, why you shouldn't do it. What type of social media marketing works, whether, you know, and obviously we, you know, the whole thing about don't just post buy my book. I mean, that's just, I'm not going to go into that because that's been repeated 100 million times. And we all should know that at this point but unfortunately most authors continue to do it. It doesn't work, you know? So, but it's just very important to, to just find this, a small, even if it's just a small group of people, but you know, if you find somebody who is successful, you know, don't be afraid to reach out to them. You know, don't be asking them for favors. You know, you just meet, you say, oh, well, this person's successful, and just send them an email. Hey, will you help me out? Because I've actually been through that. That's really annoying. You know, I actually had an author, and I'm really helpful. I love to help people, but sometimes you got to say no.
And there's a certain level there that it feels like, you know, there's definitely, like what you were saying, like, seek help, build relationships, you know, listen, pay attention when, you know, you're looking at other successful authors or other successful people, you know, you can certainly learn from them. But yeah,
but
there's also a certain amount of legwork.
Build a relationship with them, though. I mean, don't just, you know, reach out to them because you want them to do something for you. You got to build that relationship.
Yeah.
And that's the same thing goes with readers.
Yeah.
You know, build a relationship with, you know, with, as far as social media, you know, if you're constantly just, you know, saying, buy my book, you know, you're not going to build that relationship. So why should they? You know, but if you start building a relationship either through a blog or social media, and you're just kind of interacting with your readers, with your followers and everything, then they're going to probably, you know, eventually they may, hey, you know what? I like this guy, or I like this woman, you know, who's an author. And it's like, I'm going to check out what they're writing. You know, maybe, you know, when you have a sale, it's like, well, it's 99 cents. Yeah, it's 99 cents. I'll go and check them out, you know, and, you never know when you get that life, you know, that lifelong fan, you know, who's going to, you know, read everything that you write. That's how Stephen King started. You know, he didn't start off a millionaire. You know, Stephen King started from the very bottom. He actually started plagiarizing at the very beginning, you know,
and it was a kid.
If you read, it's a really funny story. You know, in his memoir, he basically, when he was a kid, he wrote a story, and it was actually basically somebody else's story, but he, you know, he didn't know any better. So he wrote it down and everything. He put his name on it, and he was selling it to friends at school. And his teacher found one. I think it was the principal or teacher, somebody found, who was looking at it. It's like, you can't be doing this. This is against the law. So yeah,
funny.
It's a really funny story. So, but you know, but that just goes to show that, you know, anybody can be successful, you know, if you just really put the effort into it. Sometimes it just takes luck, but it does take a lot of work, you know. So I mean, if you're wanting to be an author and your goal is to become a millionaire selling books, you know, well
you
chances are that's not going to happen, you know. But if you like me, you know, I have a different definition of what success is for me. You know, you have a different definition of success, what is for you. And every author has that different definition, you know, of what is success. You know, success can mean
definitely
different.
Definitely a personal thing, yeah.
It is a personal thing, you know. Success may be making, you know, selling a million books and becoming the next Stephen King or your favorite, whoever your favorite author is. I mean, it's kind of a high, you know, bar, but, you know, good luck, you know. But, and success may be, you know, selling, you know, 50 books, you know, or I mean, in my case, it was, you know, selling more than 100, you know, that to me was a success, you know. And, but it just, as long as you're having fun and enjoying the process, that I think that's all that really matters. That's the most important thing, is enjoying whatever you're doing, whether it's writing or whatever your career is. If you're enjoying what you're doing, that's the most important thing. And money, it doesn't matter what amount of money you make, as little or as much as it is, as long as you're enjoying it, I think that's the most important thing.
I agree. Happiness, man, it's key. And, you know, you got to follow your heart if you can, I think.
Yep.
Yep. Yeah. Well, I think I have some crazy expectations as far as my end goals, but I'm going to keep plugging away at those.
Yeah. And it's good to have, you know, high expectations. I mean, have some really tough challenges and tough, you know, goals that are really hard to reach. It's something to shoot for.
Yeah. Well, I don't like being bored, so I guess it works out.
Yeah, exactly.
I can't
and, you know, you, when you don't make those, when you don't make those challenges, you know, those goals, you know, that's okay. You know, you just, you know, you make adjustments here and there, and then you do your best. But the most important thing, like, if you stop, you know, you're never going to meet your goal if you just stop trying.
That is so true. A persistence, keep going, patience, preference, lots of things that start with P, apparently.
Yeah, perseverance, right. So, a word I always misspell every time.
It's
really annoying when you type it. It's like, okay, the Microsoft Word, whatever, it's going to correct it for me, and it doesn't. And so then it's like, you know what? It's funny, on that same note, it's like, I don't know if you've ever dealt with the same thing, but it's like when you're writing a story and you're trying to, make it kind of flowery or whatever and make it sound like, like you.
Like, I know what I'm doing.
No, you're doing exactly.
Yeah.
And then you're writing this word and then you just can't, it's like, how do you spell this word? Sometimes it's the simplest thing, but it's like, I just, you keep getting that red squiggly line underneath it. It's like, how do you spell this? And then finally you just like, screw it. I'm just going to completely rewrite the whole line, the whole sentence, just not use the word. But
that definitely happened to me before. And there are certain words that for whatever reason flare up. So like if I am like, in the rhythm, I'm feeling my characters. I've got the plot rhythm down which, isn't always the case. Sometimes I'm like, right. What happens next? The word necessary. I don't know what happens to the C's and the S's. But like I messed that word up so bad that uh-huh. like the spell checker is like, I can't help you.
Yep, it's just like my perseverance. I can never spell that word to save my life sometimes. It's just, I'm getting better at it. But yeah, it's just, as far as, like writing, certain, when you're writing is, you've noticed, writing, reading Devil's Nightmares, it's like, I typically don't use a lot of real flowery writing. I don't go into, I don't go into too much detail. I try to give just enough detail, but I like my readers to have a little, to kind of use their imagination also. And, so I don't go into, I'm not going to, spend, four chapters, describing the scene, and I mean, four, paragraphs, which now there are certain writers that are really, really good at that. I'm humble enough to know that it's not my style.
Yeah.
That's not my style.
Well, that is definitely something that plays in is like the natural style. I mean, I happen to love the style of Devil's Nightmare, and I'm not finding lacking of anything. I'm not wishing for more. I think it's great.
And I like to keep it, and what I've been told is it's kind of a fast paced, the story keeps moving forward. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what my goal was. So I mean, hopefully, I think it succeeded.
Definitely.
There are a couple of small slow spots into it. And I did that kind of, to slow it down for a purpose, so it's just not completely, just go overboard. Sometimes you need a break, to get away, kind of breathe,
It is a tough balance though, I find. Cause like, I know with the Ruby Dawson saga, it is pretty fast paced and I do try to keep it going. But at the same time, it's like, okay, well, do I need to take a second? Do I need to give my readers a chance to get their grip? But at the same time, I mean, as a reader, sometimes it makes me crazy when I'm like five chapters in, I'm like, when is something going to happen?
Right. And, it's like, that's where, I mean, if you read, the expert, you read from the experts, it's like, when you start your novel, I mean, you want to try to start like in the middle of something.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where I mistake. That was one of my biggest flaws in my first novel, Pursuit of a Dream, because that one kind of drags on. I mean, and for one thing, it's really long. I mean, it's like, 488 pages in 6x9 format. It's long.
My very first novel is about that. It's pretty long.
Eventually I'm going to rewrite it and shorten it up a bit. Yeah. But yeah, it's really long. The reason is sometimes you just gotta now, and I've learned since then, like with Devil's Nightmare, it kind of gets right into the action. It's like right in the middle of something. I have a little prologue. Some people don't like prologues. I like prologues, it kind of gives you, and if in horror, that's kind of typical anyway in horror.
Yeah.
But when you go into chapter one, that's when you meet Aaron Sanders, and that's when it is in first person, because you'll notice in the prologue it's in third person.
Yep.
When you go into chapter one, now it's in first person and the rest of the book is all in first person and from Aaron's perspective.
I really like the contrast there, because I really like the prologue. And I don't like all pro- I don't like all prologues. I really like your prologue, and but
and it's short. It's also short too.
It's true. I really like it. And but when you go from your prologue to your first chapter, and then by the time I got to chapter two, I'm like, okay, this is awesome. Really love it. It's a great contrast because the prologue does a really great job giving this general, the setting.
Right.
I feel like I'm there. Mm-hmm. And then chapter one, I'm like, okay, now I really care. I really care about, about what's happening. So I right. really like it.
And it gets pretty crazy pretty quick. Yes. and I was really, I was kind of, it's like, well, because of the kind of the theme of, I'm not really getting, any spoilers really, because at the very beginning, it's in the sample. In Amazon, where, there's kids that are killed and, in the story and, teenagers and young, it's like, how are people going to take that? And it's like, it's kind of a tough, I tried, to write it in a way was because I didn't want it to be too graphic because of that reason. And really, and some people think it still is kind of graphic, but I've actually toned it down, believe it or not, than the original, because it's like, my mind when I'm writing, it can really go out in left field and get really out there and twisted. Yeah, so, there's some things like, that I've really, there's certain scenes that I've really had to tone down, because it was just too much. And, but because me personally, I don't like reading like in horror where it's just all blood and guts. I like having the character development and the a little bit of story in it also. But although I do like slasher films, which is pretty much no story and all blood. But
well, there's usually somebody to root for though.
Yeah, there usually is, and it's usually the bad guy. because the victims are just, usually just, they deserve it. Nine times out of 10 in a slasher horror film, which makes it fun.
Terrible decisions.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, you deserve to die. Yes. Have you not ever seen a horror movie?
Well, my first, I think I was like, I don't remember how old I was. I felt like I was pretty young when I watched Scream.
Oh yeah.
And which was a kind of a funny, not that it was my introduction to horror movies. Right. My dad was a huge horror movie buff and I watched, Attack of the Crab Monsters and Night of the Living Dead before I was seven.
Right. That's kind of where I am. It's like watching Friday the 13th, but I was about 7 years old or so, I guess, when I first saw that one,
I was like five when I saw Child's Play, and I saw that.
Oh, that's.
I saw that by accident. Like I had a. I went downstairs thinking I was getting one over on everybody else.
Yeah, that'll give you nightmares.
Yeah. I pretty much stopped playing with dolls.
Yeah.
Yeah, that
Poltergeist is what did it for me. I mean, when funny story about Poltergeist with that creepy clown.
Oh my.
Okay. God. True story. My grandmother had a clown that looked just like that thing.
No.
I am dead serious. Every time I'd go to visit grandma, okay, I'd go, I grew up in Austin and then I'd, travel 2 hours, she lived in a smaller town. So I'd go and visit her, usually during the summer or during like a winter vacation or whatever. So I go to grandma's and spend, a week or so, whatever, hang out, spend time with grandma and grandpa and plus my cousins were all, lived in that town too. And anyway, so it's like, the bedroom that the guest bedroom that I would stay in, and she loved, not like porcelain does, but just this, she loved clowns. On my dad's side, she was really into clowns too. So I was like, geez, what is it with these clowns? both of my grandparents, they just love clowns. But after watching Poltergeist and then having, and it was really bad because she had it in a chair.
Gosh,
so I'm like, I swear I could not sleep in that room. It just had this creepy clown was just staring at me. Okay. And then with the poltergeist, I just knew that clown was just going to attack me. It's just like,
totally. I mean, that movie has just ruined clowns for me. I mean, so this past
it's either that or Stephen King's It that does it for people.
Yeah, that didn't help. No, it did not help. This past Halloween, I had taken my kids to the to their elementary school Halloween party, and there was a haunted house, and I was like, oh yeah, if it's at an elementary school, I can handle it. They can handle it. At first, it was totally fine, and within like the first corner, there was this clown, and I was like, oh wow, that's a decent prop. And then the clown isn't a prop. It's a person dressed in a costume, comes out right of the box and starts kind of like makes an advance. I cover my kids' eyes and just scream and start running, and I make that's them funny cry, and they're like, mommy, I want this to be over. I'm like, it's okay.
It's not real. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, clowns are terrifying.
Yeah, but it's funny. It's like, you know, I mean, people that I know that are just totally terrified of clowns, and it's, you know, they all, most of them that I know, it's because of Stephen King. And I mean, me, I mean, it's like, I mean, I'm not, I mean, I clowns don't freak me out at all. I mean, now, I mean, no, but some people are just totally, I mean, it scars them for life.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm pretty
cool. And for me, obviously, I guess I lucked out, you know, they didn't really, although that poltergeist clown that my grandmother had, that almost did it.
Yeah. No, that...
it came pretty damn close. But, but aside from that, I mean, it's just, it's really, I think it's funny. I mean, for people who, I mean, I know the scientific term, I forget what the actual scientific term is for fear of clowns, but, starts with a C. Look it up on Google.
I think I've
call a phobia or something. I can't remember what it is. But anyway, I mean, it's a real thing, and I know it's not funny, but it is kind of, you know, when people freak out about clowns. But you know, and you know, it's like with me. It's like me. It's cockroaches. You know, I can't. That's for a lot of people. But I'm not afraid of them, but they completely, totally creep me out. Okay. And if you've ever seen Creepshow, that didn't help.
No, I wouldn't think that it would.
Yeah, that one episode with the cockroaches on Creepshow, that did it for me. I mean, I don't like cockroaches to begin with. But then again, in my grandmother's house, something about my grandmother's house was just, you know, I mean, I go to my grandma, and, you know, growing up, if people, you know, who may be from Austin or that central Texas, you know, the cockroaches in Austin are typically not very big. Okay, at least back when I lived there, they weren't. I mean, they're, you know, who knows where they are now. But anyway, they're typically, you know, like inch long, you know, small cockroaches. Okay, in South Texas, they're huge. I mean, and they got wings. They fly. Okay. So I go to my grandmother's house again. You know, I forget how old it was, maybe 9, 10 years old. So I'm going to grandma's house, and this freaking cockroach dive bombs me. Sounds like a B-52, you know, fleet. You know, bombing me. It's like, you literally hear this. It's like, and it nicks me on my head. And, yeah. So, I mean, that totally freaked me out. And then my grandfather, another totally grossed out episode with cockroaches, you know, where he's in the den, he's watching his Western. He loves Clint Eastwood and Chuck Norris and all that. And, so he's watching his Western TV on a TV show. And so I go and, you know, I go to sit down and, you know, with my grandfather and this huge, you know, cockroach, probably about 2 or 3, I mean, it's probably at least 2.5 inches in length, you know, big ass cockroach. It's crawling across the floor. So my grandfather, he's smoking a cigarette and then he sees that cockroach. And I was like, oh, grandma, there's a cockroach. So he jumps, he gets out of the recliner and he crushes it with his bare hand. And then he proceeds to light a cigarette, you know, to get a cigarette. And then he starts smoking a cigarette like nothing. I was like, whatever, you know, after crushing with the same hand that he crushed the cigarette, crushed the cockroach with. I'm like, what is it with? Oh, it was disgusting. But yeah,
the kind of stuff that sticks with you. I mean, I remember, and I wasn't a terribly young kid either. I was probably closer to preteen than, you know, any younger. And I remember I had a popsicle and I sat down on the front steps of my, you know, my house that I was living in at the time. And I happened to sit on an anthill or ant colony that lived in the stairs. And I was dripping popsicle juice all over my feet.
Oh, man.
So I looked down at some
point. It's like ringing a dinner bell.
Yeah, I had, exactly. I had, my feet were covered in ants, and they were climbing up my legs, and I am not okay with ants. Like, not at all. And it makes me crazy when they're in my house, but, yeah, no, that just, anytime I see ants, they don't have to be anywhere near me. I'm like, oh, cause they were just all over the place. It was awful.
Yeah. I got family in Mexico. And so, you know, when I was a kid, you know, we used to always go to Monterey, you know, Mexico, you know, for vacations where we spent time with my cousins. And anyway, my cousins and my aunt, they had a house, and there was a big field, and there was a lot of, you know, there's a lot of desert out in Mexico, but anyway, there was this big field. It was all dirt. And, so we go, but they had these huge carpenter ants. They were big, those big red ants. I mean, we got them here too, but I mean, they have a lot there. There was a lot of them there, but, yeah, we used to catch those damn things like idiots. We just like, okay, you know, we go to a comic, because they didn't create mounds like red ants that we have here. And I mean, they would literally burrow into the ground.
Right.
And so, I mean, we'd find them, and we'd see a whole colony of them. And then we go there with the jar. We just start scooping them up and say, oh, look, we got all these ants. It's like, you know, we take them to the house and like, what the heck are you doing?
Yeah.
It's like, I mean, when I was a kid, it's like my brother and I used to do the, you know, crazy stuff like that too. I mean, in Austin, we used to live in a house, there was a forest right behind it, which is funny. It was actually the house, the forest in my short story in the upcoming collection is actually based in that neighborhood. It's fictional. I fictionalized it, but it's based on, you know, in that forest. But anyway, so there was the forest. We used to always go out in there, and we'd go critter hunting, and we'd bring back all types of stuff. And we'd drive my mom nuts.
Snakes.
We'd bring snakes, and not just any snake. I mean, my brother, he brought a coral snake.
I was losing my mind.
A coral snake, a really venomous snake, you know. So, look, Mom, what I got. You know, it's a pretty, you know, look at these pretty colors. You know, of course, he knew what it was, but he didn't care. And, of course, I'm like, oh, this is cool. So then, you know, like a dummy, you know, I'm, you know, 6 years younger than he was. And so I go in there, and it's like I find a coral snake with my neighbor friend, and we see one crawl into the neighbor's wood pile. And this snake was about three times the size of the one that my brother caught. It was a big snake, and it was a coral snake. So like dummy me, you'll say, well, let's go catch it. And like, not really realizing how poisonous that snake was, you know? And, you know, one time we caught a giant centipede. I think it was about a foot long.
Oh, wow.
And I, you know, growing up, you know, playing Dungeons and Dragons and stuff like that, I thought that was just something, you know, that you would find in Dungeons and Dragons. Little did I know that they actually existed. You know, the biggest centipede I'd seen was like, you know, 2 or 3 inches, you know, at the most. And so I'm thinking this, you know, I lift up a piece of wood and I see it. I'm thinking it's, you know, a rubber toy, because you see them at the stores all the time. Toys, we buy them, store, you know, and then it moved. So, and then my brother, he goes and he gets a milk jug, and somehow, I don't know how he did it, but he manages to lure the thing into the milk jug, into that little hole in the milk jug. And of course takes it home, puts it in an aquarium. And, hey, look, Bob, look what we caught, you know, needless to say, it was gone the next day, but yeah, we would catch some, crazy thing, tarantulas, you know, giant centipedes, poisonous snakes. It, you know, yeah, we drive her nuts. I guess,
you know, growing up in Texas, that's like what you guys have out there, right? I mean,
well, yeah, I mean, in central Texas, you know, plus we lived like right, you know, in the middle of it was a new development.
Okay.
And there's, you know, it was just like surrounded by woods. And so there was a lot of, you know, we had, just a lot of stuff out there, you know, tarantulas, you know, and, but I mean, we didn't have, you know, with like mountain lions or anything like that. But,
no, I meant like, yeah, like tarantulas.
Just a lot of interest. Yes, snakes, lots of snakes, lots of lizard. I mean, yeah, there were a lot of, you know, a lot. We ran into snakes all the time. But tarantulas, you know, you'd find them in the front yard. And of course, I'd pick them up and play with them. And, you know, but yeah, it was interesting. But
growing up in North Jersey, I didn't have a lot of nature at my fingertips. So then when, you know, about 10 years ago, I had moved to the Pacific Northwest, the Seattle area, and my mind was just blown compared to like the kind of like the spiders we have out here are just so much bigger than what I was used to in northern New Jersey. But nothing like tarantulas. I don't know.
Yeah. What could do. Yeah. Yeah. We had some pretty big ones, you know. It's funny. The funny thing about the tarantulas is like the first time I saw one in the front yard is it was dead. You know, it was either dead or it was the molt. You know, it had shed and, you know, it almost looks like an actual tarantula, but it's just the skin, the molting. And so I found one. So I said, oh, look, you know, so I, you know, picked it up and threw it away. Well, then there was another tarantula I found, you know, it's like, you know, it was early morning. So I go out there, oh, there's another dead tarantula. So I grab its leg to go pick up and throw it away. And it was alive. And that was kind of shocking, but, you know, and so it lifted its legs and got all defense, you know, that little defensive posture and everything. Yeah. And of course, after the initial shock, I wanted to play with it. So I, you know, let it calm down and eased it onto my hand and say, hey, look what I found. Yes. But yeah, my brother was really nuts. I mean, he used to catch scorpions.
Wow.
And he would, and just no lie, I mean, he was nuts. I mean, he would catch these scorpions and have, I mean, he would catch, you know, he'd have like a, you know, dozen, 15 scorpions, and he would go around the neighborhood and show off. He'd have these scorpions crawling around his arm, and he would go to the neighbors, and people would give him money, you know, for that. He would just, you know, like some freak show, you know, we go around and people would give him money, you know, he was just showing off. And he was nuts. You know, he gets stung all the time, and he didn't bother him. But, you know, I got stung by a baby scorpion. And, oh, my God, talk about it. Man, that hurt. I mean, the baby ones are the worst.
Really?
And, yeah, we were playing with the scorpions, and I got on, you know, I crawled, you know, knelt on top of one, you know, on my knee, and it got me, and boy, that, man, that hurt. I don't think anything's hurt more than that. I've ever, yeah. Oh my God. But my brother was nuts.
I can't even imagine playing with scorpions. I mean, seriously, like there is like a spider the size of my thumbnail anywhere near me, and I'm on the other side of the house.
Yeah. Yeah. People always like, you know, I always joke about stuff on, you know, like on Facebook when I, you know, we see all these, you know, jokes about, you know, spiders and, you know, you find a spider and then you, you know, burn the house down, took care of the spider. Yeah. You know? And, you know, I always post stuff.
Giant,
you know,
bowls on top of it.
Right. And I post stuff on Facebook all the time, you know, stuff like that, jokes. Like that. But, you know, and the thing is, I'm not as scared of spiders at all, you know, obviously. But, you know, there's very little things that really, I mean, cockroaches about as far as, I mean, I'm not scared of them, but they creep me out. But as far as any other type of nature, and, you know, bugs, scorpions, spiders, they don't bother me at all.
That's snakes. Cool. I'm pretty squeamish with bugs.
But we've had some interesting pets. I mean, I've had my dad, you know, he's big nature. He loves nature, animals and everything. And that's kind of, me and my brother, we take after my dad, you know, when it comes to that. And but we had a 7.5-foot boa constrictor as a pet. And in that same house, it was funny because we take it. It was actually my brother's snake. But, you know, and I ended up, you know, taking care of when he went off to, you know, to the Marines and fight a war and everything. So I took care of the snake while he was gone. But so then the snake, we would take it out in the front, you know, he'd take it out in the front yard, and we lived in the suburb. It was kind of, you know, it's now it's just completely, you know, engulfed by Austin. But back then it was out on the outskirts of Austin. So it was in its own kind of secluded suburb. And but, you know, one time we had a cop that actually lived down the street, and he drove by one time. We see this, you know, he sees this big ass snake, you know, in the front yard. He just like stops and he backs up and just like, holy crap, you know? So, but yeah, back then, I mean, there's just, you know, in Austin, we used to have, I mean, there's people that, I mean, they'd have all types of weird animals. I mean, we had people with, you know, the laws were a lot more lenient than they are now. But I mean, people with lions and stuff really? Like that, you know? Yeah, I mean, it was as long as he was out in the county, it was completely legal, okay. You know, to have exotic animals like that, and so we lived on the outskirts, so we weren't in the city limits. So having the snake, which was considered an exotic pet, the boa constrictor was completely legal. And actually, when we moved to in the city limits, it was legal too at the time. But so we had the snake in indoors, and, you know, but it was, you know, boa constrictors are pretty docile. So they're, you know, they're not like, you know, reticulated pythons or, you know, a little more aggressive, but, or the Burmese pythons. But yeah. And then, I had the emperor scorpions, those big black scorpions, and I've had those for pets. It's just, yeah, we've had some interesting pets. Funny thing about the snake is, my dad wanted to get it, and my mom was like, ain't gonna happen. And, so my dad, you know, he kind of, you know, was like, well, you know, we're going to get something. So it's either the snake or we're getting a jaguar. And he wasn't talking about a car.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was either, in hindsight, I'm kind of glad we got the snake instead of the baby jaguar, because that thing would have been a pain, you know, to deal with once it got bigger.
Seriously. No.
But yeah. He was seriously considering. We almost got a baby jaguar as a pet. And, that is, so my mom, you know, she said, oh, fine, get the snake. You know, it was about 4 feet at the time when we got it. But my grandfather on my dad's side, you know, he used to have, in Mexico, he used to have all types of exotic pets. You know, that's kind of where, you know, he's like, well, I want one too. You know, dad's got it. I want one too. My grandfather, he used to have, he had coatis, he had crocodiles, and I mean, he had monkeys. I mean, he had all types of, you know, fun pets. I mean, it was a lot of fun going to his house.
I bet. You know? I can't imagine.
He didn't. I mean, I never got to get the monkeys. He got the monkey later in life, and then by the time, you know, he died, you know, he just I never got to actually see the monkey. But the coati, I'm not sure if you know what a coati is, but
I don't think I'm.
It's.
I feel like I can picture it, but I think I'm just picturing a sugar baby.
Yeah, it's kind of think of kind of explain it. It's like a rodent type.
Big eyes.
It's kind of, you know, it's got this kind of a snout.
Okay.
And, you know, medium size, about the size of a cat. Hmm. You know, and but it's just, you know, it's something that you would find in the jungle. You know, but it's very, very cute, but horny as hell. You know, that thing was like a dog, you know, I mean, that thing, I mean, literally would hump your leg. I mean, it was crazy. I was, oh my God, that thing was just, you know, but the crocodile was really cool. I mean, I think it was a caiman, but it was a baby. He had a little 2-3 foot caiman, you know, he had a little, he made a little enclosure for it. But yeah, he's just, my grandfather had some, on my dad's side, he had some interesting animals, but,
my 300 pounds of dog is pretty much all I can handle, I think.
What type of dog is that?
I have three dogs. And
oh, three dogs. Okay, I thought, you know.
I have a golden retriever, a Rottweiler, and then a golden retriever Rottweiler mix. And
right.
Together, they're 300 pounds. Because my two males together, they're a little over 100 each. And then I've got my golden, so.
Right. Yeah, I miss my, I used to have a, I've had two German Shepherds. One, my last German Shepherd, he ended up having a spinal problem.
No.
So he ended up getting paralyzed. So I ended up having to put him down. But I love German Shepherds and love big dogs. But now, you know, there's, after my first German Shepherd died, he ended up getting heartworms and was on medication. But then he got him again. And that, and the second time around, it got him. I was a new dog owner, and I didn't really know a lot about heartworm, and all the diseases they can get and everything. So they, you know, so we kind of, unfortunately, he passed away from that. Now we know better, but I know a lot better now, but, still, I mean, it was really hard. So, my German Shepherd, late German Shepherd Sergeant, I mean, he ended up, passing away. He was about 5 years old, I guess.
Oh,
so, yeah. So he wasn't very old, but, he was a great dog. I miss him, but he ended up getting cremated. So, and he's got him in an urn and everything. So, but, so he got special treatment. And I mean, one reason was because I didn't have space to bury him. So it was a big dog.
Yeah. We had to, put down one of our dogs a few years ago. He was old and he had gotten dementia and he was getting aggressive, and we ended up cremating him and having his ashes sprinkled in an apple orchard.
That's cool.
But pets. I mean, I love having pets. I'm not as good with the critters as some that you've explained, but I'm great with dogs.
Yeah, I don't have any critters like that anymore. But you know, I'm a dog person, and I had cats when I was a kid, but then I found out, you know, I was allergic to cats. I didn't even realize it until later in life, but which would explain why I was always sneezing. But yeah, I mean, I love dogs. I mean, the sad thing is, like, you know, it's like you have a dog and then, you know, you lose the dog. So, well, I'm not getting another dog because it's just, you know, they become part of the family. And
you have this big hole where they were. I know.
Yeah, it's hard. You know, it's just, you know, now I've got, I've got small dogs. I got, and they're all, three of them, two of them are rescues. One of them is kind of a rescue. And the other one was my grandfather's dog.
Oh.
And so when he died, you know, we got, you know, well, actually got him before he died, but anyway, so the Jack Russell Terrier mix, she was actually dumped on the side of the road when I was working at the newspaper. She was dumped on the side of the road with her sister and they were like weeks old.
Oh my God.
And so one of my coworkers' daughters brought her to the newspaper and was trying to find a home for them. And so I had just put down my German Shepherd, okay, recently after that. It's like, okay, I'm not – no, was it then or – I think it was then. It was when I got the Beagle. But I got the Beagle first, but that's another story. But this one, you know, it's like, well, okay, well, I'm going to try to find a home. So we found a home for one of them, and then I was like, well, I was babysitting while I was working. I was babysitting the dog while I was working. So, yeah, I was very productive that day. So I was going to take it to the one of the local shelters, and so I was arranging. You know, they had this foster program, but because the dog was so young, they weren't sure if they would be able to place him. And I said, well, you know, see if we can. And they said, well, we'll see if we can do it. And so I said, well, we won't be able to do it until Monday because it was on Friday. So I said, okay, well, I'll just go and keep the dog for the weekend and I'll take it on Monday. 2 hours after I took the dog home, the dog had a name. So that was over.
Yeah.
So, and she was so tiny but yeah, she turned out to be that was the dog that, you know, before we started the podcast, you know,
oh, the one that likes to stay close to you.
Yeah. That's her. And, so there's an emotional, like, you know, a little emotional attachment between her and me, I guess, you know.
Yeah, totally.
I kind of saved her, and, you know, she was like, it's just really good dog, very good personality. And then Jack Russell Terriers, the Jack Russell Terrier and her is, they're very smart dogs.
They are. Is that the dog that I've seen in your profile picture?
The one in my profile, currently in my profile, that's Cujo.
Okay.
That's Cujo. He's the Chihuahua Terrier mix.
Oh, okay.
And he's the one that I just rescued last year.
Okay.
And he was actually, he was a stray out in the neighborhood and seen him around for a few weeks. And finally, I think it was around November or something. It was cold and rainy outside. And I saw him, you know, kind of wandering around in the rain. And it was kind of drizzling. It wasn't really raining hard, but, you know, so, and it was getting kind of cold outside. So I went outside and kind of, you know, so I came here, Pooch, come here. And he was very friendly. He came up right up to me and, you know, kind of eased himself toward it. And then he came up right up to me and started playing with him. I do that with every dog I see in the neighborhood. But
I mean,
dogs get out, you know, all the time. Sometimes the neighbor's dogs get out and then, you know, I play with them and then they go home. But,
totally.
But this dog, you know,
I talk to dogs and not people. And I realized that, like, I've just had this conversation with their dog and I haven't them at all. It's like, oh, you're a cute little fuzzy.
Right. So anyway, so he comes in. And so I felt sorry for him. So I bring him in out of the weather. It's like, well, you know, because it was going to get really cold. And so I brought him in and again, had no really intention of keeping him, but I wanted to get him out of the elements.
Right.
And so I fed him, you know, and I had a cage. So, you know, it was, you know, set up, you know, we had an old crate, put it together and stuck him in it for a while, for, you know, and he was like real calm and everything. Now he just, this dog just barks all the time now, but it's just really cute dog. And I said, you know what, you know, I thought about it. I said, yeah, you know, first I posted it on Facebook and I said, yeah, if you know this dog, if this is your dog, you know, claim him, whatever, you know. So I posted it on, I didn't really put a lot of effort into finding the owner if he was somebody's dog, because of the fact that he was been roaming around the neighborhood for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So if he did belong to somebody, tough, you know, they didn't deserve him. And he had fleas and I mean, he just, you know, he you know, so it's like, you know, and he was kind of thin. And so I was like, you know what? I'm taking him. I'm keeping him. So, and I always wanted to have a little dog named Cujo. So I named him Cujo.
That is a great name for a small dog.
Oh yeah. So, but you know, the beagle, she was kind of a sort of kind of rescue because, somebody, was just giving her away because the neighbor was threatening to shoot her because, she kept getting into the chicken pens. And they lived out in the country, and the neighbors, and she kept getting into their yard, into their property, and playing, you know, bothering the chickens. So that owner of the chickens was threatening to shoot the dog. So the owner decided to just go and get rid of the dog because they just couldn't, they couldn't keep her. She kept getting out of their yard and messing with the yard. So they say, well, you know, we better give this dog away before she gets shot. So I ended up taking her. She's a great dog. She's just, dog's always, always hungry. The thing about beagles is they never get full.
Yeah. But, I've got a Roddy with that issue. He can just eat and eat and eat and eat.
Yep. I was reading something about beagles. Like, beagles about, you know, one of the only dogs that you could literally eat themselves to death, you know, but they're all great dogs. I mean, they have their own personalities and everything. I love them all. I love dogs.
Yeah, me too. I'm a big fan.
But.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. And
it's a lot of fun. Wow, it's almost 2 hours already.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it was great having you on. And I will... Yeah. So can you tell people where to find information out about you, where they can find?
Absolutely. Probably the easiest way to find everything about me, my social media, where, you know, where to get my books or anything, is if you go to my website is www.sharkbaitrights. That's shark and then bait and then rights, .com. And I have all my, if you go to the about section, it has all my, actually at the bottom is it has my social media, my Twitter, I'm at SharkBaitRights, Facebook, my author page is author Robert Pruneda. And then if you want to, I'm actually, if you're interested in reading Devil's Nightmare, you can actually get it for free if you go to my website and sign up for my newsletter. Again, that's SharkBaitRights.com, and just a up in the sidebar, if you just go ahead and sign up for the newsletter, and I'll send you a free copy of Devil's Nightmare to get you started on the series, see if you like it. And then of course you can find me on Amazon. There's actually, you know, Devil's Nightmare and Devil's Nightmare Premonitions are actually going to be, if you're a subscriber of Kindle Unlimited, they're actually fixing to go into the Kindle Unlimited catalog in the next couple of days. So it's scheduled for April the 1st, but depending on how Amazon sets that up, you know, so in the next few days. But again, you can get it for free if you sign up for my newsletter. Really enjoyed the podcast. It was a lot of fun. Enjoyed talking about the Walking Dead and horror and all these other crazy stories and everything. But, it was a lot of fun. My first podcast, I think, went okay.
You know? I think it went good. Thanks so much.
Thank you for having me, and, we'll talk again later.
Well, that was cool. It was great having Robert on the show. And, for the most part, think that wraps it up for us tonight. Again, or today, or whenever it is you're listening to the show. Thanks so much for listening, and be sure to subscribe to the show on iTunes, or you can add it on Stitcher. You can follow the show on Twitter at Too Many Words Pod. That's TOO Many Words Pod. You can follow me on Twitter, me Bettingfield. come to my site, jaymethescribbler.com. Updates, new books, good stuff. And yeah, thanks for listening to the show. Before I say goodbye for the night, on the review front, if you've read The Highly Capable and like it, I'd really appreciate a review. Same goes for Too Many Words, the show here, on, especially on iTunes. Reviews, they help my career so much, and I always feel bad asking for them, but certain opportunities aren't open unless I have a certain amount of reviews. So if you do take the time to write a review for my book or podcast, thank you. Time is precious, and I really appreciate you taking yours. Well, thanks, guys. Have a great night or day or whatever, and talk to you next week.